How often do you have to work with anemic domain models? How often do you choose to hold a string instead of an object of a proper type? Culture Info defines a few useful methods we might need. Still, programmers often favor strings over even such tiny types as culture info. I also see a lot of code where numerous pieces of primitive data types are added together to represent just one thing. This is the domain class. It models a book with a specific title written in a specific language. The book may have a publication date, sort of. There are a few possible interpretations of the book's date. Don't look at me, the customers asked for all of this. Another clump of primitive data expresses the book's edition. What you are witnessing here is the construction of an anemic domain model. So I ask you again, how often do you work with such models? In this video, I will demonstrate the consequences of designing an anemic domain model. There is a narrow corner where they make sense. The rest are the projects where an anemic model causes nothing but trouble. Stay with me, I will show you how that goes along. I will also share a link to the sponsor of this video, Brilliant, where you can learn a lot more than I can tell in this video. Now to the business. The principal trait of anemic domain modeling is a complete abandonment of object-oriented programming. Primitive obsession is the signature of anemic models. I can pull out some helper classes, but those would still be obsessed with primitive types. There are a few standard excuses for this practice. Most notably, programmers testify that ORMs, such as EF Core, do not support complex domain models, hence using the anemic ones. That is not true. You don't need primitive data types to work with EF Core. EF Core supports rich domain models. You have still not seen the worst part. The author is yet another anemic domain model. However, it is not possible to include just a collection of authors. The author is a database entity too, forming a many-to-many relationship with the book entity. Despite our best interest in working with authors, we can only work with the connection table in the anemic domain model. You will now see how difficult it can get to implement domain operation in this project. The first real difficulty occurs when you wish to instantiate anemic classes. There is a lot of checking when you receive a handful of primitive objects from an external source. In some cases, we sanitize input and produce safe values. In other cases, we throw. Most of these checks exist because this class effectively does the job for several classes. If I restricted this constructor to only being called by EF Core, then I could trust that my data were valid. The other callers would call public factory methods. That will also make the issue crystal clear. This class is seven classes in one. Can you imagine that all this code is only an initialization of an object? This class is not doing anything yet. I can repeat the same process in the addition class. It is two classes wrapped into one, as you can see. This pattern repeats in almost every anemic domain model, one class representing several related concepts. That is the first significant issue we recognize in anemic domain models, the lack of any abstractions. I have completed the book's constructor. Martin Fowler explained this problem in his style. In essence, the problem with anemic domain models is that they incur all of the costs of a domain model without yielding any of the benefits. The central class, with its components, takes 80 lines of code and still does nothing. Still, the program must do something. It is typical to introduce a service layer for the functions that operate on an anemic domain model. That is the breaking point where the decision to apply an anemic domain model turns good or bad. You see, nothing particularly bad has happened yet. The bad things are only about to begin now. Consider services that will work with books. Services normally depend on the persistence layer, so here I am injecting the DB context. This project will use EF Core for persistence, then the services. We shall create the books. The protocol is quite detailed. Once we obtained the book, we added to the DB context and saved changes. It is quite normal to have convoluted logic like this in a service. If it were a web API, the API itself could be the service and this method could be an endpoint. Let me add a similar method that searches for books given a few optional parameters. Start from the books, append filters that apply and execute the query. Another service could delete a book. That completes 3 out of 4 CRUD operations. Only the U update is missing, and with a good reason. This is the breaking point which I have already announced. If all you need is create, read and delete, then you might just get away with an anemic domain model. Why would I say that? This thinking is valid in components we use inside the company, those that are not exposed to public. Business rules could have already been applied by other components. But be aware that it is only a tiny fraction of all the projects you will ever work on. 99 out of 100 projects will also require updates. Updates are the doom of an anemic model. I'll show you. There will be a lot of code from this point on. You can download the entire source code for this demo from my Patreon page. If you become a patron, you will also have access to the source code from all other videos on my channel. Let me remind you that every registered patron is helping hundreds of other fellow programmers watch all the videos on my channel for free. Now we define the operations that modify the objects, aka the update services. We shall start with simple ones like changing the book's title. I'm trying to load the book by ID, then sanitize the title. I should have done this in the create action above too. I have made the title settable in the anemic model, so I'm setting it. The model is anemic. It doesn't know how to behave anyway, so I'm fine with just setting the title. Then save the changes and confirm success. This completes the first update service. It's not scary yet. How about updating the language of a book? Another hefty piece of logic intermixed with infrastructural code. How about managing books' authors? This service appends an author. Another one removes an author. This one is more engaged, naturally. I must keep ordinal numbers straight. Customers requested another service, the one that would swap an author with the one that precedes it. And another one is going in the opposite direction. Can you spot the pattern? Requests for updates, they never end. All these new methods are effectively operations on the list. Here is another one. It moves an author to the front of the list. How on earth did all these methods come to the top tier of my application? Oops, one more. Could you imagine that? My point is that all that belongs here. Why does the collection of authors not implement the list operations? Well, it's obvious. It cannot, because this model is anemic. It doesn't know how to behave. There are 100 lines of code to manage authors, and I have just started. I could add twice that many for authors alone. I could add hundreds of lines of code for publication date and edition to combine them in mighty ways. Some proponents of anemic domain models would suggest moving each such chunk of services into their own class. Here is the new services class. That might look like something, but it is nothing but a lost opportunity to move these features where they belong, into a class referenced from inside the book model. By definition, the anemic domain model does not utilize polymorphism. Can you imagine how much we have lost by not using the power of object-oriented design in this particular case? The services cannot benefit from polymorphic execution when there is none in the class definition. This entire code base is the relict of the 1980s. Enormously large compared to what it truly does, and so inflexible that it hurts my knuckles when I type it. Only because of one detail, the presence of update requests in significant numbers. The ultimate result is a so-called fat service layer. You will also hear it called transaction script or transaction script pattern. Each method in a service scripts one database transaction. The entire application will be there, with no help from such concepts as polymorphic calls or higher-order functions, to name just two. I will not turn this anemic model into a proper domain model in this video. That would take another 20 minutes to accomplish. But if you watched other videos on my channel, then you already see the direction in which that would progress. The main impact will be on the services. There would still be the create service. However, the main validation, the construction of books internals, all that would be relocated to the domain model where it fits better. The create service will dominantly talk to the database in the end, and so do the read and the delete services. All they do is talk to the database with a touch on the domain model. But the largest part of the service layer, the individual update operations, they would just go away. There would only be one update operation in the end. It's easy to implement. Find the existing book, set the updated version, save changes. All four CRUD operations fit 50 lines of code. The domain model could easily grow to 1,000 lines of code with the operations I have in mind at the moment. Most of the application would be condensed in the domain model with dozens and hundreds of public methods, each defined on the class or interface to which they belong. I will leave it to you as an exercise to implement this domain model. Call it a homework. And if you want to learn beyond just designing a model, you can start doing that right now for free by visiting the sponsor of this video, Brilliant. Brilliant provides deep learning in specific areas of programming, engineering, and science. For example, I suggest you take their course on how LLMs work. It is informative and leads you through the interactive learning process. It is very refreshing compared to watching traditional video courses. Brilliant recently launched a ton of new data science content, all of which uses real-world data to train you. You will also find thousands of interactive lessons in math, data analysis, programming, and AI. Whatever area you choose, Brilliant helps build your critical thinking skills through problem solving. There is a full 30-day free of charge offer for you. Follow this link, scan the QR code, or just click the link in the description. That will also give you a 20% discount on an annual subscription after the trial period. So please make sure to use this link to unlock the benefits. Keep learning, what else can I say? And browse my channel to find more videos like this one.